Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to Exotic Astrology. Nice to see you back. And one of the most frequently asked questions to me by people is, I see some placement in the horoscope of my own horoscope or somebody else, but then it does not match with the reality, which means I see somebody has a debilitated seventh lord or afflicted or a bad quote-unquote Venus, and they have a good married life or they have a great married life sometimes, you know? And sometimes I see Venus is in seventh house or Lagna or the fifth or the ninth or the tenth or the fourth, very well placed or exalted, or the seventh lord is in a great dignity, but the married life is not very good, or they got divorced, or they are always planning to separate from each other, they are not happy. All right. Why does it happen that we see certain things in the horoscope and it does not match with the practicality, which means the absolute reality with a person's life? Why does it happen? You will always see this time and again. Okay. So does it mean that astrology is not a very good science? Does it mean that it has shortcomings? Well, the problem is not with astrology. The problem is with we ourselves. The problem is that we claim to have checked the entire horoscope, but we don't. Yes, we just simply don't. I know people who open the horoscope and they say, oh, your Venus is exalted, good married life. Yes, there are people like this who see Venus and they predict the entire married life. Well, that's a catastrophe. It's a epic disaster, right? The problem is we just check an individual placement and we give a blanket judgment. We make a blanket statement. We give a blind judgment, actually. Okay. And the most important thing is we do not check the dashas. Okay. So for example, if somebody has a very good horoscope, but somehow by the dint of his karma, he's running the dasha of the sixth house, then he could encounter separation in marriage or divorce, or separation means maybe he has to go to some other place for work. You know, he's not physically able to stay with the spouse. And if the 8th and the 12th houses also link, then the person could be quarreling with the spouse or end up in a divorce finally. Okay, why is that? Because the 6th house is the 12th from the house of marriage, which is the 7th. Okay, and therefore it will deny you marriage, okay? But then there's another layer to it. You got to check where the Karaka of relationships, Venus, is placed, okay? You have to check where the lords of the Antardashas are placed. Where are they sitting? They are also sitting in these houses, or they are sitting in houses which support marriage, like 2nd, 7th and 11th, okay? Now, we will not take the pain to see all these things. What we will do, we will see, okay, you are running the shop 6th house. Sorry, bad marriage. Okay. So that's the funny thing. After that, when the predictions go wrong, we are always sitting and justifying. We are saying that, oh, actually, this didn't go right, you know, because it was like this. Well, we should have seen that before. And this is with everybody. This is not only with me. I have also made many blunders. I have made many mistakes. I still do many mistakes. And that is why I'm sharing this, so that we can learn from them. Okay. And we also do not check the Navamsha chart. We do not check the divisional charts. You know, somebody is talking of marriage, we must check the Navamsha chart. And we should analyze the Navamsha in whole, in detail, as a whole, as an individual chart also. Not like trying to dance between D1 and D9. Oh, Venus is exalted here, debilitated here. You know? Uchta bhang ho gaya, nichta bhang ho gaya. I don't know what kind of terminologies people have these days. You know, the debility is cancelled, exaltation is cancelled. Okay, so it does not mean that if a planet is exalted in D1 and D9, the exaltation is cancelled. No, it does not mean that. It has a different flavor in two areas of your life. Okay. And it also does not mean if a planet is debilitated in D1 and in D9 it is exalted, then the debility is cancelled. No, there is no classic which says like that. Okay. So we need to deepen our study of Jyotish, and we need to understand that what does every planet represent, how to judge a particular event, how to judge events based on dashas, how to judge by Vimshottari Mahadasha, then Antaradasha, and then Charadasha also, Jaimini Charadasha. Because what happens is we only use things like, you know, Vimshottari Dasha, which is very accurate, of course, there is no doubt. But whenever a major event is to happen in your life, okay. Now, major event for different people, it can mean different things. For a person who is in a middle class or average, for him or her, buying a property could be a major event in his life, okay, because he might be able to do that only once in his life, or at the max maybe twice, big property of course. But suppose somebody is born in a millionaire or billionaire family, they may be buying houses every year, okay, oh, I am buying mansion, villas, you know, all these things. So for that person, it may not be a prominent event in their life, okay. Similarly, marriage. Somebody may get married, then divorce, then they may have like 3, 4, 5 or sometimes 7 or 8 marriages also. So for them, getting married the next time, the 10th time or the 5th time, it may be important, but maybe it's not a very prominent event of their life. But somebody is getting married the first time and the only time. Then that will be, of course, a very, very, very prominent event. Okay. Or suppose somebody has a childbirth, you know, then that's a very prominent event. So, or you have purchased a car, somebody is very poor and doesn't have money. So for that person, if the person has purchased a car, a very small car also, maybe after 15 years of his savings or 20 years of his savings, then that event is a very big event for him. It's a very prominent event for him. Okay. So which event is prominent or not, it will depend on what is your situation. All right. So for somebody, traveling in flight may be a very important event because that person may not have money. But if somebody is very rich, then for him, maybe every week he travels in business class or first class, you know, in different airplanes. So then for him, flight journey is like, what is this? You know? So that's what I'm saying. So you must know what is the level of the person. If he's asking financial questions, you need to know what is the level of that person, and only after then you should judge. Okay. So for example, if somebody is from a middle class family and then the person gets admission into a very very, very prestigious college, you know, of his country or some other country, you know, then that's a very big event in their life, of course, because that person is expected to earn and, you know, get money for the family or their parents or the dependents or the subordinate people, or sometimes people have, you know, brothers and sisters in their family who they get married, you know, then that is why they work very hard in the job. Sometimes they have loans, their parents had taken loans which their parents could not pay back. Now they are paying back. The son or the daughter is paying back. But suppose somebody is born in a multimillionaire family or in a very big political family, you know, then the things like education and all this hardly matter. You know, for them, degree is just like a paper, because they don't work, they don't have to find a job, they don't have to do any of these, because they have so much ancestral wealth that they don't have to do anything in their life. They can just sit and just do whatever they want, most of them. Okay, they have so much money sometimes. So you have to know what is the situation of the person, where is he born, what are his circumstances, what family he is born into. Okay. Only after that, you can, you also have to see the desh kal patra, like time, place, circumstances. Well, which year is the person born? Okay, so for example, if the person was born in 50s, so, or especially in countries like India, then it was expected that by the time you were 20, 25, you would get married. Right? So maybe a person born in 50 would have got married between 75 around, 1975 around. Okay, But suppose somebody was born in 1975, then maybe you were married between, 25 and 30, So you can see like that. Or somebody born in 80s would get married even later, because that the age of marriage is it's becoming more and more late these days. So now if somebody is born in 2050, then maybe they get married at the age of 40. Or maybe after 100 years, they don't even get married. Okay. As Kali Yuga is progressing. So that is Deshkal Patra, and the city, the country where the person is born. Okay, so you need to check all of these. You cannot just blindly see a horoscope. Okay, so suppose this horoscope is of a person who is born in a very holy city in India, like for example, Banaras or Mathura or Vrindavan or Ayodhya. And then this, the other horoscope, is of a person who is born in a city where they are doing there's too much wine, or there's prostitution, or there's gambling, or there's too much meat eating going on there. So then that person, now they may have the same horoscopes, imagine. And if you give a prediction without knowing where the person was born, what kind of upbringing the person has had, your predictions will end up in a disaster. It will be like the person will go and tell how useless and how bogus and how stupid astrology is, because it will not match. It will never match. And it also depends where you have learnt astrology. All right. That is also very important. Because if you have learnt in a traditional parampara, okay, of Jyotish, then let's take the example of relationship compatibility. So in traditional astrology in India especially, whenever they are doing compatibility matching, they will check the gunas, okay. But most importantly, they will check if, Santeep Ji came to my channel and he was discussing that if a man's sun is over a woman's moon, it is considered very good. And if a woman's moon is over the sun of another man, it's considered fantastic. So if they see these things, you go to a traditional Vedic astrologer, and then if the boy and the girl, they are having these placements, then he will say, yes, compatibility is very good, you can go and get married. But now if you go to another astrologer in the West, West mean, I don't mean who is physically in the West, but who has not learned from this Vedic style of Vedic parampara. Then if they have some other system, then in Western astrology or in the West, Venus is given too much importance. So the entire relationship compatibility is based on sexuality, or how Venus is, how love, romance. They are not very much concerned about the sun and moon. They are like, no, we will just see Venus. In some countries, I know they see Mercury to see how will the bonding, how will the friendship be between a husband and a wife. Okay, so sometimes they see the ascendant. So it depends on where you have got the training of astrology. Okay, and suppose now you have got training in a traditional Vedic parampara style, and then there is a guy who comes to you who has studied from the West. And he's coming and asking you, suppose, I have this girl, I have my girlfriend, can you check the compatibility? And then if you say, your sun is over her moon and her moon is over your sun, so it's good. And he'll be like, oh, what the hell is this person talking about? Who is interested in sun? And I'm just interested in Venus only. Okay. Why is he wasting my time talking of this sun and moon? These are useless things. And I just want Venus. Just tell me about Venus. So then you cannot tell the person, that's stupid, we should check sun and moon, because for that person, he or she values that very much. So if you don't tune into what the person is, who the person is, what is his upbringing and what he wants in life, or who he is as a person, then your predictions will end up in a disaster. Because even if you predict, the person will not be able to understand what you actually mean, or what you want actually out of that. So, and then even if you predict certain good things, then the person, good means accurate things, okay, it could be negative also, but accurate, then the person will not be able to connect with you. He will feel there's a sense of disconnect. And even if it goes to predictions go right, The person will not remember it because he has developed a sense of aversion against you, all right? So therefore, the first thing we should do is we should check horoscopes in detail, okay? And we should analyze everything, including the dashas, okay? We should analyze everything. When it comes to marriage, for God's sake, do not only check Venus or 7th house. There are three houses of marriage, 2nd house, 7th house, 11th house. So analyze all these three houses, analyze the lords of these houses, analyze the Karaka, analyze Jupiter, Sun and Moon. Very, 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 very crucial for marriage because these three ultimately sustains marriage, okay? It is not the sex life, Venus, which sustains a marriage. That doesn't sustain marriage eternally, all right? So then you check the Navamsha. You must do deep research and you should learn how to check these divisional horoscopes, all right? And then finally, check the Deshkal Patra. From which tradition have you learned? Who is the client who is coming to you? Only then you can develop a harmony. Okay, I am from this tradition. He is from that tradition. He thinks this is important and I think that is nonsense. So how do we reconcile? Okay. So you have to psychologically know how to consult a person and how to prove it. So, and there's another issue I have seen many times. People they will see videos in YouTube and they will talk of divisional horoscopes, but there are certain astrology systems in India which does not use divisional charts. And they will just use the Lagna chart and that's done, and they give very good predictions using certain techniques. Okay. Or the techniques of nakshatras and sublords, you know. So then you should, as a client, we should not go and, you know, blast on the astrologer. Hey, what is this? Where are you using Navamsha? Your predictions are useless. You are good for nothing. You are useless. You are stupid. We should not say like that. There are people who tell to these astrologers, okay, like this, that anybody who does not use divisional charts, you know, their predictions cannot become true. Well, that is nonsense. If the person's predictions are good, they are correct, then you don't have to use divisional charts. It's not mandatory. Okay. But then again, don't go to a astrologer who uses divisional charts and don't tell him that why are you using divisional charts? It's not required. All right. So we have to know and we should respect the tradition which the astrologer is following. And we as an astrologer should respect the tradition which that client is also following, all right? Otherwise there will be a mess. It happens sometimes. The client will ask you about Navamsha and you say, oh, I don't use Navamsha. And the client is asking you about sublords and you say, oh, I only use Navamsha. So there's a mismatch sometimes, all right? So therefore we should take the Deshkal Patra into consideration also, and only after that we should be making predictions, and by that we can understand that we can come to a consensus, we can bring harmony, and then we can understand how the predictions can take shape for different people. All right, so that is it from my side. And if you want a consultation from me, then you can always go to my website down in the description section. And if you're new to the channel, then please subscribe to it. And if you like this video, click the thumbs up and share it with somebody who always complains that astrology doesn't work. All right. And yes, God is there with you all the time. Just look to Him. You will find Him.